Good morning, people. How you doing? You all right? How many of you guys just got up? Raise your hands. I know, I just got up an hour ago myself. We good? My name is Leroy Downs. Welcome to the Playboy Jazz Cruise. You guys been having a good time? Man, there's been some fabulous music already, and we got, what, six more days of this? Loving that. Anyway, this is the history of jazz, so welcome to the history of jazz, and I'm your co-host, as I mentioned, Leroy Downs, but the main man is Mr. Marcus Miller. Please put your hands together. Mr. Marcus Miller.
Good afternoon. So I know what it said on the program was the history of jazz, but I know you know I'm not gonna make it through no history of jazz in 1 hour, right? No, but what I would like to do, this is 2009, which means that it's the 50th anniversary of Miles Davis's Kind of Blue, right? 50 years. So first of all, I'd like to talk about Miles and particularly that album. The first thing I want to say is if any of you guys read the jazz charts, what's amazing about Kind of Blue is that every year since 1959, it's been in the top five seller every single year, right? Everybody makes an album, you know, 1965, 1975, 85, 95. Everybody makes an album, but Kind of Blue is always a top seller, which means that all of us have been doing our job by passing on that album to the next generation, because everybody, that's the first album they have to buy, right? They say, man, I want to get into jazz. What should I do? Or I want to impress girls. What should I do?
Go buy Miles Davis, Kinda Blue, put on Freddie Freeloader and do your thing, man.
And be quiet and don't say nothing, right? Don't say anything to blow it. Just let the music do the job, you know? It's an amazing album. If any of you young people who don't have it, please do get it. We're gonna play a little bit of it, but we're gonna start just by talking a little bit about Miles.
Well, hold on a second. How many people don't have Kinda Blue? I know you're probably not gonna raise your hands. All right, there's a few.
No, be honest.
Yeah, it's interesting.
So, I'll talk about Miles a little bit first. I had the honor of playing with Miles between 1981 and 1990 when he passed in 91. I started off as his bassist. Thank you. I was 21 years old, and it was funny, I was a studio musician in New York. So I'm just going from studio to studio playing for whoever needs a bass player. You know, you walk in the studio, you read the music, you sign your form, you get paid, and then you leave, you know? So I was just bolting in New York. It was an exciting time for musicians. You know, I'd have a session for Billy Joel, for 3 hours, and Aretha Franklin, and then McCoy Tyner, anybody.
Wow,
it was amazing, you know, you just had to be on your game. You had to be able to read, and you had to play all sorts of styles. But anyway, that's what I was doing. And I'm on one of these sessions, I don't even remember who it was for, and the receptionist from the studio gives me a note, and the note says, call Miles Davis, right?
It's like, is this a joke?
No. It's not a joke, but you know, that's exactly what I thought. I thought, this is Pee-wee, my boy Pee-wee.
Right, right.
Playing a joke on me. But I couldn't take the chance, of course, and not call him back. And I called back, and it was Miles Davis. I was 21. Miles had gone into a little period of retirement. And he hadn't played a note since I was about 13 or 14 years old. So as far as I'm concerned, I didn't even know if he was alive. It might as well have said, call Jesus, you know?
It did.
Yeah. Exactly. It was beautiful. He said, can you be at Columbia Studios in an hour and a half?
Oh, wow.
I said, is this Miles? And then, of course, he cursed me out for not answering the question.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that's where I knew it was Miles,
right,
you know?
Right. It's legit.
And it was the best thing that could have happened for me, because if he had said, can you be at Columbia tomorrow, I would have had a whole day to flip out, you know what I mean?
Right, my goodness.
Miles Davis, let me practice. No, don't practice. Oh, what should I do, you know? But instead, all I could do was finish the session I was on.
Show up,
you know? And it was at the famous Columbia Studios where he had already recorded all those great albums like Kind of Blue. And he walked in the room, and I introduced myself, and I told him that I was Wynton Kelly's cousin, who had already played, who had been in his band. And he said, oh, yeah. So he said, you know, that's not going to get you anywhere with me. You know? But it's good to know, you know?
Yeah.
And he showed me the song. He said, this is how the song goes. He went, boom, boom, F sharp G.
Got it.
And what did you say?
He had a real raspy voice because he had had an operation on his vocal cords when he was younger, and the doctor said don't talk for a week or so. And the next day he cursed somebody out and for the rest of he talked like this for the rest of it, which added to his mystique, you know. But anyway, he said, "You got it, F sharp G." I said, "Okay, if that's it, I'm not going to ask you any other questions." So I sat down, the rest of the band showed up. And
don't ask questions.
Exactly. And I started playing F sharp and G, and I waited a little while, play F sharp and G again, you know. And he stopped the band. He looked at me, "Is that all you're going to play?" So I said, all right, Miles.
I got
let's
you.
Let's try it again. I got you. You know, so next I was F sharp, G, A sharp, B sharp, Q. I played everything. I threw everything in kitchen sink. And he stopped the band again. "What the hell are you doing? Just play F sharp and G, then shut up." Right? So I grew up with enough crazy people to recognize a crazy person. And what you do is you ignore them. You close your eyes and you dig deep and you play what you think is appropriate. Right? Just because he's not going to give you any help. He's just there to mess with you. So I just close my eyes and I play. Sometimes I played F sharp G. Sometimes I do stuff in when I thought it was, you know, appropriate. And he let us play the whole take. And after the take, he looks at everybody and goes, "Y'all play like a bunch of sissies." Right? And then walks out of the studio. Right? But I'm the one closest to the door. And as he gets by the door, he looks at me and goes, I went, "Woo!"
That's great, yeah.
So later on that day, he asked me to be in his band. And I stayed in his band for 2 years. I went to Europe for the first time with Miles, and it was a great experience. After 2 years, I was like, "You know, Miles, I know you're not going to believe it, but I'm going to quit your band because I want to develop more as a musician, not just a bass player. I want to learn to write and compose and produce music, and I need to get out of the band." And I knew, you know, he was going to be upset, but I was wrong. He wasn't upset. He said, "You know what, I understand. You're very talented, and I want you to grow as much as you can. If you ever need me, you let me know." Now, anybody who knows Miles Davis, that was an amazing thing for him to say.
That's beautiful. Yeah.
So, thank you. So he, I went and did my thing. I was working with Aretha and Luther Vandross and David Sanborn. I was producing and doing my thing. And a couple of years later, I called Miles back and I said, "Listen, man, I've been writing music and I have some stuff for you." And he said, "Well, bring it on." And I flew out to California. And to make a long story short, that was Tutu. I recorded this song. I wrote this song for him called Tutu, that 1985, 86. And it began my second relationship with him, but this time as a writer, I had more kind of input into his music. I was telling him what to play. That's a trip.
Yeah, I bet.
The first time, you know, we were overdubbing, and I said, you know, I can't tell him what to do, so I just stood there and watched him. And he was doodling, and he said, "When are you going to tell me what to play?" And I said, "Okay." So I brought my little horn with me, and I would just play the melodies to him, and he would take my cue. It got very comfortable, and we ended up having a very nice relationship. We did 3 albums, we did movie scores. It was very nice. So anyway, that's my experience with Miles, and I think the reason that Miles and I got along so well is that I was younger, but I knew his entire history, you know?
Right.
I knew not just what he had done last 10 years, I knew from 1945 all the way through. So when he started talking about J.J., you know, J.J. Johnson and Bird and them, I was like, "Yeah, J.J. used to wear his pants up high, didn't he, Miles?" "You know, he did, Marcus." "He used to wear his pants up like this, man." I had all the details, you know. So we got along really well. So I got a chance to see how this guy thinks, you know. And what was beautiful about him was that he was just such an honest, natural musician. The stuff that he did that's so special to us, you know, it just flowed out of him. It wasn't like he sat and said, "What am I going to do to blow these people's minds?" You know, he just, you know, "I'm tired of doing this. I'm going
to
do that."
You know, he seemed to be like one of those cats that he's always the innovator. Is he always the one that's thinking ahead and creating, and everybody looks to him for that creation? He just seems to naturally have been the guy to do that.
Absolutely. And also, you know, he angered a lot of people. Because people would fall in love with what he was doing, and then he'd switch because he hated being kind of doing the same thing over and over again.
Yeah, he's done with that. He's ready to move on.
But people got so mad because people fell so in love with what he was doing. For instance, in the 50s, people fell in love with what he was doing so much that when he switched in the 60s, it angered them.
Yeah.
It made them feel abandoned. It made them feel like maybe he didn't think that they were worth continuing for. You know what I mean? I saw it because he didn't. He changed in the 60s, so the 50s fans were upset. Then he really changed in the 70s, and the 60s fans were really mad at him. You know, and then he changed again in the 80s. I actually helped him change in the 80s, so I got to see the reaction. I got to see the people. People would write in and say, "Man, you're the devil." You know what I mean? It was so, you have no idea what he was getting. And what I learned from him, when I say he was honest, what I mean by that is people were criticizing him left and right, but it never changed his need to continue to change.
Well, that's almost kind of hard to do, because as an artist, you know, artists are people too. And when you see these things written about you, they're written about you. Now, maybe as a mass audience reads it, then it's like, oh, whatever, it can be, you know, all floaty. But when it's you, it's like everything you read with your name attached to it is personal to you, and that affects you. And for somebody to not let it affect them and keep changing styles like that has to be, you know, incredible strength.
And, you know, a lot of people who kind of read these stories about Miles, he was very rough and he had a really gruff exterior. But he was a very, very sensitive human being. And you got to know that from hearing the way he played those ballads, that there's only so hard he could be, because that sensitivity came through his music so clearly, you know. So I watched him take all the criticism, but still feel the need to continue to change and continue to develop. So we're going to get to Kind of Blue now, because this album, like we talked about, happened in 1959. I think the first sessions were in February. And the band was on drums Jimmy Cobb, on piano was Bill Evans, except for a cut two, Freddie Freeloader, which was our cousin Wynton Kelly. I say our because my family, my dad, my aunts, we're all here, the Wynton Kelly
family.
Where's
your dad, man?
Dad, where's dad? Already. Dad, hold up your hand, dad.
Stand up.
There he is.
All right.
There he is. I look just like him.
Yes, you do.
You couldn't deny me if he wanted to. He doesn't even tell anybody who he is when he walks in the club. Mr. Miller here, sit right here, right?
Yeah, right.
So Wynton Kelly played on Freddie Freeloader. Bill Evans played on the rest of the album. Paul Chambers, PC, played
goodness.
Bass.
Paul is so incredible.
Incredible, from Detroit, incredible bassist. On horns, Miles had a difficulty finding some good horn players. He had John Coltrane and Cannonball Adderley.
Two bums, right?
People are like, Miles, you got to do better in the horn section, man. So what's really beautiful about this album, first of all, the album, everything about the album is beautiful. The artwork is gorgeous. It's just a really dark picture. It's black and white with a hinge of blue of Miles playing the trumpet. That's beautiful. On the backside, Bill Evans, the pianist, he wrote liner notes for this album, which are equally beautiful because, you know, as jazz musicians, we tend not to want to talk too much about the music because we'd rather have the notes do the talking. But every once in a while, I think it's really valuable to explain to people, to listeners, what you're trying to do. And this is what Bill Evans did on this CD, on this album. And the thing I remember the clearest about his liner notes is he compared jazz to this Oriental art. I forgot the name of the art. But it's art that's done on a very fragile piece of paper. It's almost like rice paper with a pen. Is it origami? Huh? It's calligraphy. Yes, you use a calligraphy pen. And the thing about this art is that you can't go back. If you go back, you tear the paper. And you compare jazz to this because jazz, unlike classical music where you rehearse and you have the music written in front of you, and if you just practice and practice until you get it right. With jazz, you practice, but you can't practice what you're going to play because you're improvising. It's all about improvisation. And with this improvisation, sometimes it's not perfect because you never played it before. Which makes it beautiful. And it's the same thing with this art. Yeah. You can't go back, but because you have, that means you have to commit to everything you do.
Yeah.
That means this is it. This is it. This is it. And he compared the two, and it's a beautiful comparison. And I'll never forget, I read it when I was 13 years old, and I remember it clearly. And it really made me listen to Kind of Blue differently, you know what I mean? So Bill Evans wrote that, and I think it was even more important that it came from a musician rather than somebody who's writing about the music but doesn't really do it themselves. So anyway, we're going to play the first cut. The first cut is a typical Miles title. It's called So What, right? I'm sure, you know, they said, you know, Miles, do you have a name for this? He said, I don't have a name for it. Yeah, well, Miles, we have to have a name. So what? You know what? Call it that. Call it that. So what? So I'm just going to try to find this iPod so I can play. Hold on 1 second.
It should be by you.
I hear this.
What would Miles say about us playing it on an iPod, man?
Miles could play the trumpet, but he could not work electronics at all. One quick story. I wrote some music for Miles, and it was in the days of cassettes. I wrote a composition. I put a lot of time in this composition, and I sent it to Miles, and he had it for 3 days. You know, I'm going, oh, he doesn't like it. At the fourth day, I couldn't help it. I called, Miles, what do you think about the song? He said, there's nothing on the tape but me talking, right? He had pressed record instead of play. And left the thing on for the whole afternoon.
I'm waiting for the music, man.
Hey, baby, how you like this jacket? You know, I'm like. All right,
man.
Hold on.
How long did the tape roll, man?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Luckily, it was an hour tape, so we were cool.
That's right.
My plan was to play the whole thing and then go back and talk, but I can't listen without talking.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna narrate this whole thing, okay? You know the song, so I'm just gonna talk through it, okay? First of all, Bill Evans created such an amazing atmosphere with this intro. A lot of musicians play So What? I haven't heard that many people play the intro, which we just heard, but I think without the intro, you don't get the atmosphere that's created by this thing. And then, of course, Paul Chambers. I love this tune because it, you know, the main melody happens on the bass, which is very unusual. Okay, so we're gonna start. I'm gonna run my mouth, excuse me. That's Bill Evans, very simple, a lot of air, and he makes you wait. And you don't know what time this is. You know what, if it's 4-4, you don't know where you are right now. And it forces you to just kind of let go and release everything. You say, okay, I'm gonna have to go with you, Miles, because I don't know where you are, you know? Okay, here's the melody, here's Paul. Piano answer. And then Jimmy Cobb comes with that ride cymbal. John Coltrane and Cannonball Alley are just sitting there going, oh, we got to play, sorry. So that's 16 bars of the first chord. Now they're going to take it up a half step. Check it out. Jimmy Cobb. Now for the last eight, we're going back down to the original key. Now coming up is the baddest crash cymbal in the history of jazz, okay? Jimmy Cobb hits his crash to set the solos off. Check this out. It's still ringing. Okay, I had to show you the crash cymbal. I gotta rewind because Miles played a solo, hold on. That's what the soloists are gonna solo on. They're gonna solo in one key for 16 bars, then the other higher key for 8 bars, and then the original key for 8 bars. And that's the cycle, back down here. It's very simple. Okay, so try to ignore the bad crash cymbal and just listen to Miles this time. He's making this up. This isn't written. This solo is so bad that singers write lyrics to this solo. Okay, here's a higher key, half step up. Come on, Miles, where you going? Bill Evans. Back down, original key. It's the last eight bars.
Come on, y'all.
Okay, here's the most famous line, check it out. Octave lower, Miles, octave lower. And Miles put so much space in his solo that you could talk to him. What, Miles? Come on, tell me. I imagine, when I hear Miles play, I imagine my Uncle Big Willie with a glass of bourbon. Yeah, Miles. Right? Yeah. And Miles let you talk to him. What you got to say now, Miles? Now, after Miles is going to be John Coltrane, who's the polar opposite of Miles. Train has a lot to say.
Always.
Just getting started. Higher key, higher key. Completely different from Miles, right? That's what makes it beautiful, the contrast, right? Okay, hold up, listen. Train had a lot to say. He was trying to work out a lot. And he did it with a lot of notes, and he completely revolutionized the art of saxophone playing. And Miles recognized that, of course, because Miles was a great observer of talent. He recognized talent. But not everybody recognized it as quickly as Miles, right? So when John Coltrane got to playing, sometimes, this is the record, on a recording you could only play so long because, you know, the vinyl was only so long. But live, Train would go for half an hour.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And our cousin Winton would be like,
when's my solo?
Woo, okay, Train. So Winton actually complained to Miles. He said, man, dude is playing a long time, man. And Miles said, yeah, he is playing. So Miles went to Train and said, man, you know, why are you playing so long, man? And Train said, Miles, I just have so much in my soul that I'm trying to get out, and there's so many ideas that are crashing through my head when I'm improvising that it's hard for me to stop. You know, I just feel compelled to continue, and I just don't know how to stop. And Miles said, try pulling the horn out your mouth. All right, Train, here you go. And he had so much heart. You could hear the anguish in his sound. He didn't use vibrato. A lot of other tenor players played sweet. He's just straight sound.
And man, Train is, he's praying, man. Yeah, he's praying. He's speaking to God when he's playing.
Sounds like he's speaking to God. Listen to Bill Evans helping people out. Bill Evans is accompanying. He keeps that atmosphere. Instead of just playing rhythm, sometimes he just sprinkles a chord. When we go up to the half step, check out Bill Evans. One note, just help train do his thing, right? Okay. Miles did his thing with no notes, right?
Sorry.
Miles did his thing with no notes. Train did his thing with all the notes. So what is Cannonball Adderley thinking? He goes next.
Yeah, I know. He's like, man, all the notes have been played. What am I going
to
do,
There's
man?
There's nothing left to play, right? So I'm sorry, I messed my iPod up. So give me a minute to find Cannonball solo, okay?
Yeah, how'd you like to be Cannonball sitting on the side waiting for the... Oh, man.
I just leave. I would just leave. But, you know, he was Cannonball Adderley. He said, oh, no, I got something for y'all.
Yeah, well, you know, what's so beautiful about improvisation is that, you know, maybe Cannonball didn't know what to play, but as soon as Train played his last note, he got it. He got it.
Man, that's so important. Because I've been in there playing jazz. You're playing and somebody's killing it. And you're going, what am I going to do? And like Train said, you know, you have all these ideas crashing in your head. You know, which one am I going to choose? And I finally found a solution. You know, it took me a while. Just stop thinking. Yeah. And when it's your turn, something's going to happen that tells you how to start. And once you start, everything else is just a logical answer to what you play. So the hardest thing to play is that first phrase.
Yeah.
So we're going to listen to a Cannonball. If I can find a solo. Hold on 1 second.
You know, what's also so beautiful about jazz sometimes is when these guys are improvising, they can just take notes and just throw them out there and then go get them and find your way back to the music, man. That's the beauty of this music.
Here comes Cannonball.
You can't write that. You just gotta play that.
It's kind of in between, right? Higher key. He's cute. He plays cute stuff, right?
That was sweet. Oh, steady.
The blues. Cannonball said, I don't care. I don't care. I'm Cannonball. Now, Bill Evans, his solo's coming up, and he's really screwed, right? Because all this, but he said, I've been doing colors the whole time. I think I'm gonna stay with the colors. And the horn players helped him out, right? With that little ensemble part. Go up a half step, Miles. Help him out. You hear a lot of musicians try to play this song and they just boo, 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 and they kill it. It's wrong. This is where it's at.
Well, space in music is an instrument as well. You know, you just have to know how to sculpt it and use it.
So what's Paul gonna do?
He's ready, man. He's been playing that. He's been keeping the pulse the whole time, so he's ready to get off.
Exactly. All right, back to the beginning. This is the regular melody. It's the original melody. Now, can you imagine the producer who's sitting in the control room going, engineer, if you don't have the tape rolling,
right.
We're going to fight.
Don't touch anything.
Higher key, right? And back down. And they had just started recently doing this technique where instead of having an official ending to the song, they just do it like this. Should we end?
Yeah.
No, just fade it out. So you never have a sense that the thing ever ended. So what?
He's like, yeah, how was that, T.O.?
Yeah.
Exactly. So as a studio musician, I would hear after a take like that, you just go, okay, did that just really happen? You know, was that as magical as it felt? And then the engineer always goes, okay, that's a good rehearsal. Let's try record this one.
What take was that?
I think that was either take one or take two. I'm going to have to go back and see. But it was...
Was not take five.
It was not take five. No, you can tell. Because, you know, the problem with multiple takes is that if you play something good on take one, it never leaves your head. And then you're going on take five, you're going, well, I want to try to incorporate that lick from take one. And then you start getting some... pieced together Frankenstein kind
you
of stuff.
You think about it too much. You try to actually work what you did naturally, and then it doesn't work.
You outthink yourself. Yeah. So what's beautiful about this music, just like that Japanese paper, is that, you know, we're going to do this, and this is going to be it, you know? And it's beautiful. It was beautifully recorded, and everyone was inspired at the same time. Miles's wife had taken him to a ballet a week before this session.
Which one?
Yeah, and he heard some music. It was Francis. Okay. Francis, the dancer.
Yeah.
Right? Which one? Yes, it was Francis.
Well, you know, they need to know.
Yeah, no, that's a legitimate question. It was Francis. She took him to a ballet, and he heard some music that stayed in one key, and then it moved to another key. Mm. Because before this, jazz had a more melodic harmonic structure, meaning the chords moved around just like all the normal songs of the time. And this was one of the first times that you stayed on one chord. And so that's also what made it very unique. James Brown heard it and said, man, I like staying on one chord. up until James Brown heard this kind of music, he was singing regular R&B, like of the 50s and the early 60s. When he heard music like this, he said, why don't we just do one chord? And this music is very much related. People don't know. People like to argue about, you know, R&B versus jazz. I don't get in those arguments, man, because I know the connection is all very much the same thing. It's just different shadings, you know?
Well, there's also these mantras in the music, you know, when you have these rhythms and things that you keep playing over and over again. It's just like praying. It's just like when you say these things over and over again. And
yes.
I don't know the... I don't know the Buddhist chants, but I know
Nam-myoho-renge-kyo. It's all the same thing.
Yeah.
And then a rapper explained it to this. He explained it to me like this. Listen to this. It's getting better, ain't it? He never changed. He just said, it's getting better, ain't it? You know, like, same thing. It's getting better, ain't it?
That's it, man. That's it.
But you understood what he meant, is that there's something about repetition. And what's also nice about repetition, it gives you time to look inside the music. You know, it gives you a time, because this music to me is almost like a painting. You know, with a lot of jazz, it's going by so fast, you just wish you had some handlebars to hold on, you know? But with this stuff, the space was there. You know, I can talk to you as the music's playing, and the harmony is moving so slowly that it gives you time to digest, and that's what I love about this.
Yeah, that mantra, actually, it takes it. It already reverberates in your body, so you can kind of put that aside and make that a part of yourself and really start trying to listen to some of the other instruments and what they have to say. So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
So we're going to move on to the next cut, which is Freddie Freeloader. I was standing in front of the Village Vanguard in the early 80s, and this guy came to me, "Hey, man, you know who I am?" And I said, "No, who are you?" He said, "I'm Freddie Freeloader. Miles named a song after me." I was like, "Hey, guys, this is Freddie the Freeloader." He said, "Not Freddie the Freeloader. Freddie Freeloader." I'm like, "What's the difference? We know what that means, with the or without the." Anyway, I thought that was interesting. Now, this is the one song that Wynton Kelly played piano on, because this song had to be funky, had to swing. And Bill Evans was doing all that beautiful colors, but when it came to swinging, nobody could do it like Wynton Kelly.
Yeah.
I'm a little biased, but I think it's still true. You know, my cuz. So we're going to play it, and I'm going to show you how much of an influence Wynton had on this song, okay? If I can find it. Here it is, Freddie the Freeloader. Train and Cannonball are playing a three-part harmony. They're just playing two notes. Wynton's doing all the work. Okay, check out how Wynton starts his solo. He's soulful.
Conversation between two.
Yeah, Wynton was his buddy, so he's helping him out.
Oh, man.
I think Miles has had enough by this point. He said, "This is my record." No, he got one more.
Oh, Church.
That's Church, right?
Church. C-H-U-C.
I think Miles has really had enough by now. Come on, Miles. Just took over. Everybody had to be quiet. What, Miles? Miles hit the scene in New York in the 40s. He was 19 years old. And it was the height of bebop. And Dizzy Gillespie, Fats Navarro, they were playing high and fast, like intimidatingly fast. And Miles did his best to imitate those guys. But he was never quite as fast or as high as those guys. And to his credit, by the 50s, he said, "You know what? I gotta be Miles. I gotta be me." And he started using the mid-range of his trumpet and leaving that space and using that St. Louis soul that he had to try to express himself in a different way. And this is what we got now. No Nobody was holding notes that long. Miles said, I don't care, it's good.
Jimmy.
And Big Willie can talk to him. Yeah, Miles. Okay, that's Freddie Freeloader. Okay, I'm gonna play one more from this album. There's only six.
It's all right, you can clap for Freddie.
Yeah, come on.
The Freeloader.
Freddie the Freeloader. Freddie Freeloader.
Was that guy, was he a bartender or something like that?
I think he was a bartender, yeah. I don't remember, but it's something like that. Something
maybe he was trying around to get into the Vanguard, right?
He's probably trying to get in for free, yeah, exactly. All right, so there's only about five or six tunes on the whole LP. Nowadays with CDs, you can fit 70 to 75 minutes of music on the CD. And a lot of musicians feel compelled to put 12, 15 songs because it's available, which is cool. But the only difference is that with five or six songs, there's a sense of commitment to those five or six songs that you don't get when you put 15 on there, if you know what I mean. If you have five or six songs, you're saying to your listener, this is what I'm trying to say to you, and I don't need to say anything more. You got 15, you're going, well, I got some good songs and some not so good songs. You choose, right?
That's true.
And what you have is people starting to, you know, with their CD changes, they start flipping through it. I like number 14, you know?
Yeah.
Or I like number 7. But with this album, you didn't touch it. You put it on and you left it, you know, because everything, it was all cut from one cloth. You know
I mean? How many albums do you have that you actually like to play all the way through? I mean, most of the times you are selecting tracks.
Exactly. But not this one. You just put it on and be quiet and impress people with your taste.
Yeah. Right?
This is probably the most covered song. In other words, this is the song, the composition that most other musicians play. It's just, you know, it's a really cool song to play on. What Bill Evans is playing? That's not jazz. That's from like Ravel or Debussy or something.
Oh, right?
Sounds like he's in Spain. But that Cannonball brought it back down to South Carolina, didn't he? And then Miles floats on top. Four time, waltz time, right? One, two, three, one, two.
You know, what's so interesting is like, right before Miles played, he probably had five avenues to choose from, and at the very last second, that's the road he took. You know?
Yes. And the restraint. Throughout this whole album, the restraint that these guys are using, because they're all monster musicians. They could play scales that would blow your mind. Oscar Peterson, you know, they can do that. But it's all kind of, no, that's not appropriate here. The sense of what's appropriate is really apparent here. Evans finally stopped doing that trill. I know his hands are sore. He finally gave us, okay, enough.
That's church too, man.
Hitting one note over and over, yeah.
Right?
So, you know, this album was recorded in 2 days, or maybe 4 days. I think 2 days in February and then 2 days later on in the year. And that was it. And this album has been selling for the last 50 years. It's just a moment in time for them. They, you know, they probably finished a session and went and had some dinner and didn't give it a second thought.
Well, that's what Jimmy was saying. He said he had no idea that this was going to be, you know, such an outstanding album. They just went and did the session. It was another Miles Davis beautiful album, and they're ready to roll on to the next music.
Exactly.
But I think what really makes people reverberate with this music is the quiet simplicity that is played in it. It really makes you stop and think and connect with yourself and let the music connect with you. You know, with jazz, you can always think while jazz is playing. You can't think while some of this other music is playing because they want you to hear what they want to hear. But with jazz, you're able to listen to the sound and then you can hear what you want to hear. So it's all about self and how the music fits with you. Yes, yes.
Yes. I remember somebody said, well, you know, man, that sounds like, you know, they were putting the music down. Not this music. They were putting some other music that they heard down. They're saying, it sounds like dinner music. I said, man, it ain't got nothing to do with it because I play Kind of Blue at dinner, you know? it accompanies anything that you want to do in your life, this music. But anyway, as you can see, this wasn't the history of jazz, but you got a lot of sense of the history of music and what musicians are trying to achieve.
All right.
So Marcus happy birthday, Miller. Kind of Blue. Does anybody have anything they want to ask or add? Because I know all you guys are experts yourselves.
Y'all,
I mean,
got
you guys
the
are
album.
Familiar with this music, you know?
Just shake hands.
Just shake hands. All right. There we go. That's my Uncle Big Willie right there.
Big Willie.
Without the bourbon. Yeah. All right, thank you very much. Oh, go on. He said, what is the history of Miles playing with his back to the audience? Yeah. And I asked him, I said, Miles, why do you play? You know, he used to stand there with his back to the audience and people felt very offended, although they were kind of drawn in by the music. And I said, Miles, why do you play with your back to the audience? And he said, who would you rather look at? 10,000 people you don't know or your band? It was very simple. He was underneath that exterior. He was a very shy, very kind of sensitive individual, and he was just nervous, just like everybody else.
Well, you know, like you say about that sensitivity, especially how all of the critics seem to control the, not really control the music most of the time, but when they write certain things, that gets in your head, and you actually start thinking some of those things about the music, you know? Well, a lot of people do. But if all that stuff is out there written about you, and you're doing this other thing, and you're trying to remain sensitive, everybody else thinks they know about what you're talking about more than you do. Right. So that's, I guess, one of the reasons why he probably stayed closely related with his band.
His band was his support. Yeah, there was kind of like, it's us against the world lots of times, you know. Also, you know, he was a cool cat. You know, he was so into the music and serving the music that when he wasn't soloing, he felt uncomfortable standing there. Everyone's looking at him and looking at the clothes he's wearing while Train or Cannonball is soloing. He decided, I'm leaving. I'm going to let the spotlight be on these guys. So he was one of the first guys to just leave the stage while the other guys were soloing. And then he'd come back. Sometimes he'd go to the bar, get a drink while the guys were playing. And I said, where did you get that from? He said, Charlie Parker used to do that to me. He used to, you know, Miles is 19, 20 years old. And Charlie Parker would count off one of those fast tempos and play 8 blistering choruses and then leave poor Miles there. And Charlie might not come back, you know?
Charlie's outside the alley.
Outside, he's outside on the street corner doing something. And Miles like... Miles said after the 16th chorus, he didn't care what he played. He said, it's not my band, it's Charlie's band. I don't care what I play. But that's who Miles was.
Thank you. Could you tell us something about how Miles started the Birth of the Cool series?
The Birth of the Cool series. Miles came to New York, 19, 20 years old, and his father was a dental surgeon, so his father was a pretty kind of notable guy in the community in East St. Louis. And the only way Miles got permission to go to New York was to enter Juilliard School of Music as a classical trumpeter. And so Miles went to Juilliard. That's what he told his dad. But what he really wanted to do was find Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie, who had come through St. Louis earlier on and blown Miles' mind. He said, that's what I got to do. I want to be with those guys. So he enrolled in Juilliard. He took his classes. But he also was hanging out at night in the bebop scene, 52nd Street, yeah. You know, hanging out at all the jazz clubs. And he met a young arranger named Gil Evans, who was the complete opposite of Miles. He's like a straight white guy, you know, really kind of introverted, and he wrote all sorts of beautiful arrangements. And after Miles got through with his bebop period, hanging out with Charlie Parker and those guys, the first thing he did on his own was he and Gil got together and decided to try to do something that was an extension of bebop, just a little bit more cool, because like I said, Miles wanted to get back to playing a little bit more, something that fell within his personality a little more. And Gil helped them, and they had an idea, let's use instruments that aren't usually associated with jazz. So they had a euphonium, which is like a small tuba. They used French horn. They used really interesting instruments. And they had this cool vibe. It was probably the precursor to Kind of Blue in terms of the atmosphere. And this was Birth of the Cool. So what are some of the cool Birth of the Cool titles? Who knows a Birth of the Cool? One album was called Birth of the Cool. And what was the other one? Giroux. There's a bunch of them. But that was in the early 50s. That was Miles' first step out of bebop. And then he went into hard bop, which was bebop, but just with a more blues feel. And it's really cool, and it's really easy. If you're interested in Miles' hard bop period, well, The Birth of the Cool, you can get that album, you'll know what I'm talking about. Hard bop, there are four albums that have similar names. Working, Steaming, Cooking, and Relaxing, okay?
Chilling with Miles.
Right? There are four albums, and that's Miles in his hard bop period. Pretty cool, really cool albums. And then he went into this period, so what, you know, with that stuff. Then he went to the 60s, and he had Herbie Hancock and Wayne Shorter and blew people's minds again. Then he started wearing big glasses and bell-bottom pants and vests in the 70s, right? Then he went into retirement. Then he came back, and that's when I joined his band, and he was wearing all sorts of, like, Japanese stuff with shoulder pads. And
what'd you think about this shirt, Marcus?
Yeah, exactly. He used to invite me over to the house. He said, come over, and he'd have me trying on clothes. So he could see what it looked like. He'd be like,
that's cool, now take it off. Shit.
He said, I don't like that, keep that. I was like, I still got him too. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed it. Thank you very much. Yeah.